reached out the Lord Almighty. Yeah, who can stop the Lord Almighty? And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Click up just still, just a hair. The Lord Almighty, Lord. And who can stop the Lord Almighty? And who can stop the Lord?
It is time. Good morning, Freshwind. You guys are the early ones. You are the ones who are here. It looks like many people are still probably sleeping. Good morning. I said good morning. Good morning. Well, welcome to the morning session of the conference. Good morning to everybody watching online at catchthefire.tv. Corey is not here. Okay, no worries. Well, we're going to open up with some prayer this morning. Are you guys excited for the day? Excellent. We're going to have a good session this morning. We have Bethel music here. I said we have Bethel music here. We're going to be hearing from our senior pastor this morning, Steve Long. I said we're going to hear from our senior pastor, Steve Long. There we go. And leaders in the house, if any of you are youth leaders and you're here with your youth group, after worship, we have a special treat for you. We're going to have a session in Overflow 3 with all of you and David Slyker this morning. All three leaders. I guess your leaders are sleeping in as well. All right, why don't you turn to someone next to you and say, good morning. Are you awake? Well, It's been good so far, hasn't it? Is this on? Is this on? I said, it's been good so far, hasn't it? Good. I'm glad. Where? I have a joke for Corey. Did you guys notice Corey was wearing a baseball cap yesterday? Did you notice it was a Yankees cap? Our senior pastor asked me specifically to get this Blue Jays cap for him to wear this morning. So we're going to very lovingly ask Corey to wear this. Anyways, I'll leave this here for him. But let's start with some prayer. Father, we welcome you in this place this morning. We ask, God, that you would have your way. That, Lord, this morning as we worship you, that you would be glorified, that your name would be lifted up. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would continue to move in our hearts in greater measure, that, Lord, you would pour out your Spirit upon us. God, I ask that in worship you would just release a greater measure of your Spirit in this place. Father, we ask for more of your anointing. We ask for more of you. Lord, we know that you have poured yourself out for us and that there is nothing that we can do for more of your love. But God, we also recognize that as vessels, we can hold more of your presence. That, Lord, we can be filled even greater. And so, Lord, this morning we ask that you would fill us to overflowing, that you would increase our capacity to retain love this morning. Father, would you allow us to look around and see those around us through your eyes and not our own? So, Papa, would you stir up love in this place this morning? Stir it up in this place. We worship you, Lord. Let's just take a few moments to wait on him. Keep coming, Lord. Keep coming, Lord. He's here this morning, guys. He's here this morning. God desires to meet you face to face. That scripture that I've said a few times, if you seek me, you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. Papa, our hearts are open and we are here this morning waiting on you.
A little big, I think. Gotta represent the six, right? Feel good? I'll save it for after, okay? Don't hate. Y'all good? Alive? Alright, here we go, let's go.
Thank you.
Who can stop the Lord? For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Sing it out. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah, who can? Come on, sing it out. Who can stop? For who can stop the Lord? Oh, there is no one, no. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Yeah, who can stop the Lord? Come on, he's the lion today.
Sing that chorus with me again.
For our God is the lion, the lion.
Come on.
He is roaring with power and fighting.
Ooh.
We'll bow before.
He's the lamb.
And our God is the lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood and heaven will bow before the lion and the lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
Holy Spirit, increase your presence all across this place right now. Make us aware again. The fullness of the living God dwells inside of each one of us. The same God who created heavens and earth, he lives inside of us. Holy Spirit, we focus our attention on you. Thank you for your perfect peace. Thank you for your goodness, your kindness. Said that out of our innermost parts would flow rivers of living water. This morning, begin to overflow out of us. Rivers of living water. Rivers of life flowing out of us. The fullness of God living on the inside. We tap into that reality right now. All across this place, just close your eyes and turn your hearts and your minds inward right now to the Holy Spirit, the very reservoir of life living inside of us. All across this place, just say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you chose to come and live in me. My guarantee of eternal life. My comforter, my healer, the Spirit of truth. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let's look at him right now.
and we wait for you. Yeah. And we wait for you.
You're all we want today, God.
And we wait. And we wait for you.
You're all we want.
And we wait for you. And we wait for you. Yeah. To walk in this room today,
today, today, today, right now, right now.
Release the fullness of your spirit, Shekinah. and we want more. You move, and we want more. So we want the fullness.
Help me say it.
'Cause you move, and we want more, God. Yeah, you speak, and I want more. You move, and we want more. And we want the fullness. You move now. 'Cause you move, and we want more, more, more. Yeah, you speak, and we want more. You move, and we want more. And we want the fullness. One more time, say, you move, and we want more, yeah. God, you speak, and we want more. You move, and we want more. We want the fullness. Release, release the fullness of your spirit.
Come on. David, you might need to talk to me a little bit there, brother. Tell him don't hold back. Don't hold back now. Come on. Okay, James, talk to me. Come on, there's joy in this house this morning. There's life in this house. Shekinah,
Help me with them claps. Release them. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah again. Release the of your. Yeah. Shekinah glory in this house. Shekinah glory come. Release the of your. Do 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 do. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah. Oh yeah, release the of your in this house. Shekinah glory come. Yeah, Shekinah. One last time, release the. In his goodness today. Trust in his goodness today. Yeah. Peaceful. Oh, like a river. Oh, like a river. Help me with some snaps. Just keep that vibe going. There you go. Yeah. There's peace flowing through this place today. When we recognize who he is, what he's like, worry about the future fades away. Cause you don't have to worry about tomorrow. No, you don't have to worry about tomorrow. Cause he's got you in the palm of his hand today, 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 today. And that's what matters, that's what matters. Yeah. Shekinah, hey, release the fullness of the Spirit, Lord. Shekinah, yeah, Shekinah, one more time. Release the fullness of your Spirit. Shekinah, glory come. Shekinah, just the voices. Release the fullness of your. Come on. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah again. Release the fullness of your. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah.
One more time, release the fullness of your Spirit. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah, say it again. Release the fullness of your Spirit. Shekinah glory come, yeah. Shekinah, last time, I promise, every voice, release the fullness of your Spirit.
Shekinah glory come.
Shekinah
glory come.
Cause I love you, Lord.
Yeah, let it rise, let it rise.
And I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul. Rejoice, take joy, and take joy.
His eyes like flames of fire. He's looking right back at you. Straight to his heart.
And I love you, Lord. And I lift my voice to worship. To and oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, and take
joy
straight to him. And in what
you
and may it be a sweet sound. Sing that again. May it be
sweet
sound. Sing it again. May it be a sweet, sweet in your ear. In your ear. Oh, love you, Jesus. Today, look right at you, Lord. sing right to you, God. 'Cause you're worthy, beautiful Jesus. Yeah. Worthy Lamb of God, we adore you. Say la na 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 na, yeah. Yeah, just let that love song rise. It's like a pleasing fragrance to his heart this morning. Gentle love song. You have no idea how it moves his heart. You have no idea how it moves his heart when you lift your voice to him. Just lift it up, just sing your song, no matter how weak it is and how insecure you feel. Just lift your voices to the Lord. Just let that song rise to him. He's stirring up hunger today. He's stirring up passion today. The kind that doesn't leave after a conference, but the kind that abides like a fire in your soul. And will you receive it today? Just say yes, say yes. Will you receive it today? Oh, just say yes, say yes. Oh, stir it up, stir it up, stir it up like a fire. Stir it up, stir it up, just like a fire. The stagnant waters of our souls, God, come today, come today. Just begin to cry out for that hunger. Just begin to cry out for that new passion. A fire ignited in your soul for years to come, for decades to come, not just 3 days. Oh God, pour it out. Hey!
Across the room, let's just lift our hands to him for a second. Father, place a fire deep inside of our hearts. Like Jeremiah said, your word was a fire shut up in his bones. For years to come, Lord, passion in this room. For years to come, real relationship with you.
more than a fun song or a dance. Relationship that sustains hearts, Lord, like a fire shut up in our bones. Passion, true passion in this room.
Yeah.
this is Sarah, and she had a picture during worship that I think totally fits in with what God's doing here today. So Sarah, tell us what you saw.
Hey, so I saw this massive cloud over the congregation, and as we were surrendering, I saw this almost like liquid love coming out of this cloud, and I saw these labels all over each one of us, what people have said and what's been spoken over our lives. And I saw as we started dancing, actually, they like started falling off all over the floor. And it's like we were trampling these things. Come on! And the main thing I heard God say was, there is no such thing as being a rejectable person. You are so accepted that you cannot be rejected. And I just want to pray over you guys. Father, I ask that every word that has been spoken over our lives that does not say who you say we are, that just says that we aren't lovable, that we're rejectable, that we're not wanted, that we're nothing but our talents, that we're nothing but what we can offer this world. God, we thank you that you are enough for us. Simply by being your son and your daughter, even in our sin, you chose us, Father. Thank you that we don't have to work for your affection, but we can dance upon the injustices of this world, and we can dance upon those things because we are free. So yeah, we just declare that in Jesus' name. Woo!
So like Sarah was saying, we are free in Jesus. And so right now, if you feel like you have any of those labels or you've had them, we're going to just dance in a moment here just for a few minutes with the band. But if you feel like you have these labels that have been spoken over you or put on you, we're believing that as we dance, they're going to drop off of you in the name of Jesus. So I'm just going to start declaring a few of those labels that we want to see broken in this place, and that is rejected, despised, depressed, sick, hurting, suicidal, unwanted. Those labels are breaking off in the name of Jesus right now. Unwanted, again, unwanted. That's broken in the name of Jesus. So we're going to dance these things off of us. Sound good? Lift up a shout. Come on. Our God is victorious. Our God is Jesus. Our God is the one who conquered the grave. Our God is the one who has conquered all labels. He is the God who has spoken identity into us. He is the God who looks at us and calls us his own. We love you, God. We so love you. Father, we thank you that we were made to be with you. That God, we were made to know you. That Lord, we were made to be close to your heart. You are worthy, God. You are worthy of all praises. God, you are worthy of everything that we have and more. Lord, our words can't even begin to describe how worthy you are. Guys, as we lift up a shout in a minute, it's not for the band, it's not for us, it's not because we're asking for it, it is because he is worthy. And so as we lift up a shout in a moment, I want you to know that you are raising your voices in adoration and worship of Jesus, not for anyone else to see, not for anyone else here, but for you to speak out and shout out your praises to God. So Lord, as we lift up our cry, we worship you in it. Let's shout it out. You are good, right? Excellent. Thank you so much, Corey and the band. Whew. Anyone else a little tired from jumping? No? I am. Anyways, as you guys are finding your seats, give someone a high five. Say hello. High five. Great job. As you're finding your seats, actually, I'm going to call up Caleb. Caleb over here is part of the worship team. I met Caleb maybe 5 years ago. We've seen each other randomly over the years. So Caleb is part of Corey's band. He's been traveling with him for many years. Been part of IHOP Kansas City, also leading student ministries at your church. And we asked Caleb to come and just share with you for a few moments about his experiences, how God's brought him to where he is, and also about his involvement with Freshwind years ago.
Well, my dad actually came out right at the beginning of the 90s, first to Catch the Fire conference. And I remember he just came back, and that weekend changed his life more than any other weekend of his life. He just came back, and I remember he was just up every morning, 6 a.m., praying, and we started doing renewal services at our church, and I honestly thought it was all kind of weird. My dad was kind of being weird, and I didn't really know what was going on. I was pretty young. But I came out to Freshwind first when I was 13. I was here when I was 13, 14, 15. Actually, is Lissa McCarthy, are you here? Came with Lissa McCarthy, her boys. My parents would come out here. And truly, I'm not saying this just because I'm on the Freshwind stage, but when I was here, I always knew the Lord was real. I always thought the Lord was real, or so I thought. I came here, I remember the first time, walking in this building, and it was right when worship started. I just remember that first song being played. And I just started crying, and I never in my life had started crying when I didn't know I was crying. I just started weeping, and I'm like, in my head, I'm thinking, why am I crying? Nothing's sad happening, you know? I'm 12 at that point, you know? The only thing that makes me cry is, like, Where the Red Fern Grows, or, like, a super sad movie. So, it's a good one. So I'm like, why am I crying? And the Lord is just coming on me with his presence, and I feel him. I remember crying through most of that worship service, and the Lord just, I mean, essentially saying, I know it sounds so simple, but I am real. I am real. Coming back, this was always a highlight of my year, coming to this conference and experiencing the presence of the Lord. And actually, when I was 15, so the last year I was in Freshwind, I remember being right in the back of this building, right about where they put those dividers up, and we were about to leave the conference, and I'm just standing back there as a 15-year-old, you know, I don't know who I am, I don't know what I want to do, and all I know is I feel like I'm made for God's presence, and I'm made for his glory, but I don't know how to express that. I don't know how to pursue it. I'm kind of, as a 15-year-old, I'm like, I don't know what that looks like or how to do that. And I'm right there on that back wall, and I'm standing there, and the Lord speaks to me, and he says, you are going to be on that stage leading songs that you wrote from a move of my spirit. And I weep. It was amazing. But I cry for the next 30 minutes. It was really weird. Like, everyone was asking my youth pastor, like, why? Like, on the way back, because we're like walking back to the hotel. I'm like walking, and I'm just like, I'm just like crying. And everyone like thinks like, you know, something horrible happened, or I'd confess some like, you know, massive public sin or something. But I just don't know what to do, because the Lord speaks that so clearly, and I remember like being like, well, okay, you know, well, I shouldn't say that word, because, you know, then it makes me, you know, look like my goal is to be on a stage, and we all know our goal isn't supposed to be on the stage and whatever. But the Lord just spoke it, and honestly that word, that encounter, and just the way I felt the presence of the Lord and how clearly He spoke. It became like a plumb line for me, and the next 3 years after that, I was like, okay, Lord, what am I supposed to do? And He sent me out to the International House of Prayer in Kansas City, and I started playing with Corey and some others. And around 2007, there was a student awakening there, and we were started to write songs just from the same place that I experienced here, the presence of the Lord, an encounter with His presence. And Ben and the crew here invited us to come. It was 5 years ago. It was exactly 10 years after I was in the back, and the Lord's like, you will sing songs. And it wasn't like just generic, like I can say that now. Like, I wrote it down. I told my whole church after that. I told, like, everybody knew this word that the Lord had spoken so clearly to me. And so 10 years later, we're leading these songs that I helped write out of the presence of the Lord, leading the next generation into the presence of God. And it was just such a clear reminder to me. And what's so amazing about that is not, I didn't take that word and then I tried to, like, you know, make it happen on my own. That's not what we do with the prophetic. The prophetic, the spirit of prophecy, is just the testimony of Jesus. That's what Revelation 21:22 says. It's what Jesus is saying. And Jesus, who saw my future, looked at me and He said, I'm going to give you this word so in 10 years when it happens, you'll know that I saw you, that I put my spirit in you, and I'm not going to take my hand from you, and there's nothing you can do about it. And looking back on that, even this weekend, as I'm just thinking about what this conference specifically and this ministry has meant to me, is it so has marked me with this, like I said before, kind of a plumb line, that I am not to make decisions, or I'm not to decide for myself outside of the presence of God. Life doesn't make sense outside of His presence. We can't make decisions, we can't decide what we want to do, who we want to be, whatever, if we're not in His presence. When we're in His presence, we're looking at His face, He speaks to us who we are. He speaks identity. You are my son, you are my daughter. This is what you are called to do. And anything outside of that is us trying to make something happen. So I'm just so grateful for this ministry. I'm so grateful for Freshwind, truly, for setting a table for me to come and encounter Christ, which was so valuable for me. And I want to implore you, you know, don't make decisions. Don't try to make sense of your life outside of the presence of God and who God says you are.
That's great. So if any of you feel like that resonates with you, you're asking God, what am I meant to do? Or you're just in a place of saying, God, I need to hear you speak to me. Show me what you have for me. If that's you, I'm going to get you to stand up here right now. And we're going to ask Caleb just to release that Holy Spirit would come and speak to you clearly. So all around this room, just stand up if that's you, that you want God to speak just to you about what He has for you and the plans and purposes.
God, you are the good shepherd. God, you are the leader. You are the author, the one who has wrote every single story in this room. God, you have chosen them before the foundations of the world. You knit them together in their mother's womb, and you have a plan for their life. So, Father, I ask that you would speak your words of identity over every single one who's standing right now. God, I ask that you would let them know who they are and what they are to do. God, that you would keep them on the path to life. God, I ask that your presence would be the only thing that leads them. God, you would be their fire by day, and cloud by day, and the fire by night. Father, like Israel heading out of Egypt, where they just had to look and stare at you and follow your presence, God, that they would follow your presence and they would follow your voice. God, I rebuke every lie of the enemy, every other voice, every other words that man has put on them to say, this is who you have to be or this is who you are, negative and positive. I break off every word that isn't directly from the Father over their life right now in the name of Jesus. And I speak destiny. God has a calling. God has a hope for your life. He has a future, and it's far more glorious than what you have in mind. The Lord says the best is yet to come. Just follow me. Follow me in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Caleb. All right, youth leaders, as we mentioned earlier, we have a special session going on for you right now with David Sliker. So if you are a youth leader in your church or you brought a group with you, we'll take care of your youth. We'll dismiss you to come back before the service is over. So if you want to stand up and head to Overflow 3, which is one of those back rooms back there, our staff will bring you in and show you where to sit. And while we're doing that, I'm going to invite two of our small group leaders up. We have Gina and Rahel. And this morning, they're going to share another prophetic word with you.
Hello, my name is Gina. I hope you are having an amazing weekend so far at Freshwind. So I have a word today. I have a word for, I saw like a picture in my mind of somebody wearing like, it's actually I think more than one person, but wearing like a red cardigan, red jacket. It wasn't like a hoodie. So if that's you, you're wearing like a red jacket, red cardigan. If you could stand up. I also felt this morning that there's a girl around here who was wearing like a cream colored shirt and a blue baseball cap, that this also applies to you. So you want to stand up as well. So yeah, red jacket, red cardigan, and one girl over here who has a blue cap and a cream colored shirt. Perfect. Okay, so I was just praying and I felt like I saw this picture of like a castle, this huge, massive castle. And I felt like God was saying to you guys that inside this castle holds all these incredible, amazing things that are from Jesus' heart. And so I felt like he was inviting you into the castle. And when I went inside of the castle, I saw that there were so many rooms, like huge, huge rooms. There was a room that had like this massive kitchen that obviously where you can get your food and your nutrition, your nourishment. I saw this this huge storehouse of just like even a shirt that you wanted or a shirt that you needed and down to like something that you're gonna need in 10 years. And then I also saw this big hospital that would provide all of your physical needs as well. And so through that, I feel like God is saying that he wants to provide every single need that you have. He already has what you need and what you're gonna need right now and in 10 years from now. And so I also felt like it was an invitation to go inside of that house. That house is his home, it's his heart. And I feel like he's inviting you, like, I want you to come into my heart, I want you to come into my house and receive what I have for you and just have relationship with you. And so I feel like that also confirms some of the word of last night, that he's going to meet every single need that you have according to his riches and glory. And so I just bless you to know that he knows every single detail of your life, he knows every single need that you have, and he wants to give that to you. And I bless you for even deeper relationship with the Father.
Awesome. Yeah, and so with that, I had this word for a girl in worship. She was standing, worshiping in this section. You had long brown hair, kind of curly with glasses, and you were wearing a gray cardigan. If that's you, if you can just stand up or wave, I don't know. I lost you, I can't see you, but you were standing over there, and you were beside someone with like a red hoodie. And anyways, the word that I had for you was, I saw this picture of the sky, and the sky was really, really dark. And in the darkness, I saw this really radiant, and it was beautiful, and it was this beaming star. And I felt the Father saying that that star was you. And basically, it's not that you have been separated, but I felt him saying that he has really set you apart and that you really are just this beaming, shining light in the darkness, that everywhere you go, you carry this light. And with this light, it was just this beautiful sense of compassion and this powerful love that you show people. And I just felt to encourage you that, you know, even through the hard times, that God sees you and he knows you and you are so known to him. And every door that you felt was closed, every opportunity that you felt was missed, was really just him protecting you and just guarding your heart. And I want to just encourage you to keep showing that love and keep showing that compassion, because that's going to bring so much healing and so much freedom. And people are just going to sense just the love of God in you, because that's just who you are. You are beautiful, and he loves you so much. So I just want to bless you with that.
Thank you. And for those of you who haven't had a chance yet to check it out, Fresh Rock is going on next door in between the sessions. The School of Ministry is hosting that, so it's going to be great, so make sure to check it out. Few things to announce just before we welcome up our incredible speaker this morning. The entire Resource Center is having a sale today, 10% off of everything except for the sale items. So if you want to pick up a CD, a t-shirt, those kind of things, head in there sometime today. Speaking of CDs, how many of you really love the worship music so far? Awesome. Bethel Music has a new CD called Have It All. It's just been released a few weeks ago. We have it in the Resource Center, and our speaker today also has some really incredible books. How many of you have ever wondered how to heal somebody, how to be able to pray and see someone get healed? Have you been wondering how to do that? Steve has a track record, a proven track record, of seeing people healed almost all the time when he speaks to them. And it's not because of him, it's because of God in him, partnering with him. And his book he's written is called This Healing Belongs to Me. And it gives some step-by-step instructions on how to see people healed, which is always something great to learn. So you can pick that up as well. Well, as I invite up Steve, I said that I would share a funny story about him. Steve was my junior high pastor 20 years ago. That says a lot for how old I am. I'm 32, and I'll never forget when we moved from our old building to this building, Steve hosted a junior high sleepover at the old building. And I think it was the night before we were handing the keys to the new owners of the new building. And we had a pizza party. And at some point during the sleepover, I don't quite remember how it happened, but a massive food fight broke out. Like, pizza slices were being thrown on the walls and at people. There were pop cans. We popped a little hole in the front with a pen, shook it up, and pop was everywhere. And it was a lot of fun. Steve was a great junior high pastor. All I remember is I don't remember us cleaning it up. That's the part that I don't remember. So Steve is going to be sharing with us today. He's our senior pastor here. Would you guys join me in standing and welcoming our senior pastor to speak this morning?
Thank you, sir. You may be seated. Thank you. I wasn't a very good junior high pastor, so my technique was lots of food and food fights. That seemed to be the two good things to keep junior high kids involved. I had one other thing that it was sort of maybe a little bit of my mischievous part of me, but when Ben was a younger guy, 12, 13, 14, half of the guys in junior high had never touched a girl, like with their hand or anything like that. And so half of them were terrified of that, and half were praying that it would happen. And so what we used to do on a regular basis was play the game Twister. How many remember Twister? And it was just like it forces it. And so it was just sort of like you've seen some guys, you know, they don't want to touch the yellow spot because, you know. Anyways, that was sort of, do you remember that, Ben, playing Twister? Yes, very good. Ben now has a wife, so that's good, very good. Yay! I don't know if you've picked up a little of the sub-theme that God has been doing this this weekend. I feel that one of the things that he's been trying to get you to realize is that there's hope for your life. If God is in your life, there's hope. I was really excited to hear Patty's story last night. I read her book maybe 2 years ago when it first came out. I happen to know some of the people that she's talking about, some of her friends, and God bless that lady. But if you don't know anything about her and you just picture what it's like to be in a really, really hard place, growing up and all that kind of stuff. She was very calm in terms of describing all that kind of stuff. But she began to make godly decisions when she was 17, when she gave her life to Jesus. And what you see on the stage last night is a lady who's been putting God first, putting God first, putting God first, in a situation where most people would say there is no hope. And a whole bunch of people her age just never get to any kind of significance in their own life, never become a giver in terms of loving other people, giving to other people. They are so needy, so hurt. And I just was listening to her last night as she's talking and just feeling, oh my goodness, isn't God good? Isn't God good? Caleb, when he was just talking right now, of just what God did for him as a young guy when he came to this conference. There was a couple up last night. I don't know if you caught who they are. Paul and Yana used to be volunteer youth pastors at this church. When the revival began, they were just shortly after that, very involved in leading worship in the youth group at this church. And Paul is on 5 television shows in Canada and the U.S. I don't know if you've seen any of his shows. They're called like Decked Out, Deck Wars, Deck Disasters, all that kind of stuff. And he's one of the coolest guys, and he's always been cool. He's just always been, you know, nice hair and walks and struts and all that kind of stuff. And I just love the fact that God loves to take people and when we begin to say yes to all the things that he has for us, he begins to make our paths straight. And has been said by almost every speaker, Satan is all about getting you off your path, off your destiny that he has for you, and it's lying, lying, lying to you. And if you begin to believe the lies that God has, you end up in a disaster. But the good news is that there's a God of hope. So we want to talk about that today. So guys, if you don't mind putting my PowerPoints up, I like to be teaching with PowerPoints, and so that's what we're going to do today. We're going to talk about finding hope. That's our theme today. And we're in a world where it's just like everything's messed up. Everything's messed up. So I'm not sure that global warming has really been proven, but climate change definitely is happening. Like, God bless global warming in the city of Toronto, but we only had like 3 times that it snowed really all year. So that's heaven for Canadians, right? No snow. I think maybe accumulated, we had something like 2-3 inches of snow in my house this year. And sometimes, like last year, I think we were like 3 feet of snow at one point. It was just like, oh my goodness. But this is really disconcerting to a lot of nations and to a lot of cultures where things are just massively turning around. I talked about this last Sunday morning to our church, but the average Canadian household owes $1.64 for every dollar of income that comes in. That's not good. And friends, you're growing up where your parents have more debt than your grandparents did and their grandparents, and it is going to be affecting our culture where there's so much debt. The Canadian government, I know there's lots of people who aren't from Canada, but the Canadian government has forecasted a deficit this year of $115 billion. Like, that's huge. That's way past ever in the history of our country before. And they're spending money because they're feeling that's the best way to sort of stimulate the economy and get things back on track and all that kind of stuff. And so we'll find out if they're right. But debt, corporate debt, government debt, household debt is just terrible. Do you know that in February, we were one day away from World War III? Like a month ago. The news sort of covered it, but it sort of didn't cover it. And I think that the news were just really holding back all the media outlets. But there was a day in February last, 1 month ago, when 100,000 Saudi soldiers were about to invade Syria. 100,000 of them were about to invade Syria. The U.S. government was partnering with them, and they had battleships, they had their fleet ready to go, they had aircraft ready to go to invade that country. At the very same time, on the other side of Syria, the Russians, with their allies, were ready to go, and both of those groups are partnering with different groups that are fighting against each other in Syria right now. Are you aware of that? The Russians are bombing the friends of the U.S., and the U.S. are bombing the friends of the Russians. And it came to a place where those world governments were, like, really close, really close. And both leaders, Obama and Putin, not to poutine, so that's a food, isn't it? Putin. I'm sorry, but I really like poutine. That's, if you're an American and don't know what that is, it's French fries with cheese curds and gravy, and it is so good. The only problem of eating poutine is you're probably going to go and see Jesus a week early. It's not the best for your insides. Anyways, we're in a time where there's a lot of conflict on the world stage. Poverty and famine are continuing to be huge, huge issues, especially in nations like in African nations. Just the level of poverty in our world is just terrible, terrible, terrible. Most people, do you know if the fact, how many of you have more than five pairs of shoes? Okay. So you are in the top 5% of the world of owning five pairs of shoes. Do you know that most of the world doesn't have one pair of shoes? And so here we are, some of you have huge closets full of shoes. And you're thinking, well, I don't got much going on for me. Well, a whole bunch of the world is just very, very opposite. And then there's terrorism. This was a picture from the Paris bombings that took place, but we just had last week in Brussels in the airport. And it's like, what happens when those kind of things begin to happen? What changes in the culture? Canada last year, for the very first, not for the very first time, but for the first time in a long time, had one person shot and killed by a terrorist in Ottawa. And for those of you who didn't hear about it, it was just like, how is it possible that a guy got into the parliament buildings? It'd be like getting into the White House. For those of you that are Americans, into the Senate. And it just happened that this guy somehow got in a side door where there was no security, and he's got an automatic weapon, and he's looking for people to kill. It just happened to be a quiet day. But over here in a room is the Conservative Party. In Americans, it's like the Republican Party. They're having a caucus. All the elected people are in a room. No, because it's private what they say in that caucus room, there's not even one security person in that room. Not one person. No one is armed in that room because it's Canada. You know the difference between Americans and Canadians? A Canadian is an unarmed American with health care. So that's who we are. Yay! This guy was right outside there, and one of the other parties, which is a little bit more like the Democrats, was right across the hall, and this guy's firing bullets through those doors. In the Conservative part where the Prime Minister of Canada, Stephen Harper, was, there's the only weapon is a flag stand with a flag, Canadian flag. And a guy took it and he's standing at the door, gonna poke someone if the guy comes through. And it's just like Canada was rocked and all that happened was one person died. Well, Brussels, God bless, but was it 30 people died? Paris? 90-something, 97, I think it was, people died. And it's just massive trauma that comes. That's on the world stage. Well, what about you as an individual? This gal took her life 2 years ago in Halifax. We have a big group of kids from Halifax. Where are they? Yeah, they're over here. Not a big group, mild group, small group, semi-loud group. This girl was 14 years of age, and pictures of her got out on the internet, and it just so crushed her that she took her own life. She was 14 years of age, and she was being bullied. It's still an ongoing issue in Halifax, which is one of the largest cities on the east coast of Canada. Do you know what her tattoo says? Strength and courage. And even though that's what she was trying to do, she couldn't stand all the stuff of bullying that was going on. And supposedly 20% of all of you are being bullied right now or have been bullied. And it can be oppressive. It can be so hurtful to everything in your spirit that you're, and then combined with what Satan says, and you begin to think there's no hope, I'm gonna give up. 44% of youth live in fear, not just are fearful, but live in fear, and big issues. Unemployment in Canada is 13.3% that just came out. So when you finish high school, and if you go to find a job, good luck finding a job. Even if you get a university education, good luck finding a job. Adults, the unemployment rate for adults is half that. In Americans, it's 10%, and the national average in America is like 5%, 6%. So if you're a young adult, even with a university education that you paid $100,000 for, and now you're in debt for getting your education, no guarantees about jobs these days, are there? It's a challenge. And suicide, 20% of all suicides come from your age group. We had a gentleman in this church, probably about 50 years of age, that took his life about a month ago. And it's just terrible what it does. He's got four daughters, and God bless these girls. We had a memorial for him last week, a week ago Monday, and his daughters were just sitting right over here. And God bless them, but they're angry at their dad. His friends in this church are angry that they never got a phone call. How come you didn't phone us and tell us that it was this bad? And when someone dies, it's like they're obviously giving in to some of the issues, but it's not just that they've given in, it's like shame comes on everyone around them. It's just a terrible, terrible thing. 20% of youth are experiencing depression. Like, we're not just talking about having a down day, we're talking about living in depression and just having a really tough time of having any kind of hope and optimism for life. Patty talked about this last night, but 1/3 of all the girls in this room have or will be sexually abused. And 1 of every 5 guys in this room has been or will be sexually abused. That's just terrible. Not good stats. And yet, that's the world that we're living in, isn't it? And loneliness. Supposedly, your age group are more lonely than single seniors. And it's like we got all this social media going on, and yet the stats are that 9 out of 10 of you have no one to phone, no one to talk to when a real life crisis happens. You don't know who to turn to, don't know where to turn. And these are terrible, terrible things. And these stats are not just in our society, but they're also very prevalent in terms of churches and Christian faith. So we want to talk about faith today. And this is the verse we're going to focus on. We're going to come back to this verse. It's from the Message, but it says, may the God of hope, what's the next word? Fill you. Fill you up with joy. Fill you up with peace so that your believing lives, filled with life-giving energy of the Holy Spirit, may brim over with hope. That's God's intent for you. I have a theory about the Bible, and it's this. Every time that there's a verse like this that is a declaration verse of what God wants, there's a story to back it up. A story in the Old Testament, for the most part, that illustrates a New Testament truth. And so we're going to look at one of those Old Testament stories in just a moment. I like going to Israel, and this is the south of Israel, south of the Dead Sea. It is wasteland. Nobody lives there. A few nomads, a few Bedouin live in this area, but for the most part, it's desolate. And this is where David in this story is going to be taking place. It's in this kind of atmosphere where there's just nothing. It's ravines, it's hills, and this is where David is hiding for 16 months while he's on the run from Saul. Saul is his father-in-law. That complicates it. When your father-in-law is the king and he's got a private army. And David is on the run because Satan has filled Saul's heart with lies about his son-in-law. And there's all sorts of jealousy going on. There's all sorts of issues. And here's David as a young guy. Friends, he is 24 years of age when he's on the run. 24, he's a young adult. He's just gotten married, and his wife's stolen from him. He's separated from his wife, not by his choice, but father-in-law's taken back his daughter, one of the princesses, and he finds himself running for his life, and it turns out that all sorts of people who are also on the run and are misfits and just don't fit in. It's a little bit like Robin Hood and his mighty men, or was it mighty men? No, merry men, that's it, yeah. David was the mighty men, Robin Hood was the merry men. 600 men plus their families begin to align themselves with David. And so here's the story, it's from 1 Samuel chapter 23. David stayed in the wilderness strongholds in the hills of the desert of Ziph, so that's what we were just looking at. Day after day, Saul, who is the king, searched for him. But who? Can you say that again? But God. This is very important. We're going to be coming back to these but gods. But God did not give David into his hands. Does David know that? We're not really sure if David realizes how God is working in his life and how God is orchestrating things. But David is a guy who, to the best of his ability, is going to put God first all of his life. He's already written a hit song, a hit worship CD, entitled Psalm 23, The Lord is My Shepherd. It's already out there in the charts. He's a famous worship guy. He pushes in for God. And now, for whatever reason, his father-in-law, who happens to be the king, is after him and trying to kill him. And so he's on the run. Off he goes. And so he's in there, and God is not giving David into Saul's hands. While David was in Horesh in the desert of Ziph, he learned that Saul had come out to take his life. Saul's son, Jonathan, the crown prince, the guy who's supposed to be the next king of Israel, Saul's son, Jonathan, went to David at Horesh and helped him find strength in God. You see that little phrase? Helped him find strength. We're going to come back to that phrase in just a moment. Here's what Jonathan says. Don't be afraid. He gives him a prophetic word. Don't be afraid, he said. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. And the two of them made a covenant before the Lord. Then Jonathan went home, but David remained in Horesh in this desolate area with 600 people and their families. Hide and seek is easy for the most part, isn't it? You find a spot where you can fit. You hide behind a tree. You hide behind a couch if it's inside your house with your grandkids, as I do. You find a spot. But if you're trying to hide behind a tree with 600 men and their families, 10 kids average at least, so you're talking 6,000 people trying to hide is not easy. Not easy. And so all the pressure's on David. It's like hiding, one guy hiding, easy. 6,000 people hiding in the wilderness, not so easy. People are going to figure out where you are. Spies are going to figure out where you are. People who don't like you are going to figure out where you are. People who think that there's a good reward for turning you in are going to find you, and that's exactly what happens. So David stays in this area, and verse 19, the Ziphites, the people living in that area, went up to Saul at Gibeah, which is where his palace is, and they said to him, is not David hiding among us in the strongholds at Horesh, on the hill of Hilkah, south of Jishum? I think I'm saying those names wrong. Now, your majesty, come down whenever it pleases you to do so, and we will be responsible for turning him over. We're going to find this guy and give him to you for whatever reward there is. We're going to put him into your hands. And Saul replied, the Lord bless you for your concern for me. Go and get more information. Find out where David usually goes and who's seen him there. They tell me that he's very crafty. Find out all about the hiding places he uses and come back to me with definite information. Then I'll go with you, and if he's still in the area, I will track him down among all the clan of Judah. And so these people, they set out, went back home to Ziph, ahead of Saul. Now David and his men were in the desert at Maon, which is another area in this remote area, in the Arabah south of Jeshimon. So this is going down towards Saudi Arabia. Saul and his men began the search after they get the information. And when David was told about it, he went down to a rock, one of those big hills that we just looked at, except it's an isolated hill. And he's on this hill, and he's in this area. And when Saul hears about this, he went to the desert of Maon to pursue David. Saul was going along one side of the mountain. So I want you to picture a big hill. And Saul's going up one side, and David's already up here. And they're going like this, and the problem is there's the top to the mountain. And sooner or later, you can't go any higher, and there's this footpath. And so David's going up, and Saul's right behind with 3,000 elite guys, elite soldiers, trying to track him down. Saul's going along one side of the mountain, and David and his men on the other side, hurrying to get away from Saul. As Saul and his forces were closing in on David and his men to capture them, a messenger came to Saul saying, come quickly. And the Philistines, they're raiding the land. And so Saul broke off pursuit of David and went to meet the Philistines. And this is where they call the place Selah something. And David went up from there and lived in the strongholds of Engedi. So he moves location. It goes further north to an oasis called Engedi. So we want to talk about three quick little things here, and then we're going to have lots of time to pray and to invite the God of hope to be a part of your life. That was that key verse. The God of hope wants to fill you. He wants to fill you with joy. He wants to fill you with peace. He wants to help you in your believing life, trusting God. And if you do that, if you choose to be a believing person in who God is, then his promise is he will overflow you with hope. Overflow you with hope. Be able to put a smile on your face in spite of all the circumstances that are going on in your life, in your family's life, in your community's life. Whatever's going on, God can put a smile on your face because you have hope. And the key thing is, it's a God of hope who's going to do that for you. Not you trying to work it up. God wants to pour into you, even today, and give you some of this hope. So number one, three things we're going to look at. Number one is David has a loyal friend. This is one of God's gifts to you, is someone that loves you unconditionally. Someone who will come to you and help you when no one else will. God bless Patty last night as she's sharing, but she mentioned who that person was. It's a youth worker by the name of John Brown, and if you go to Stratford, Ontario, he's still there. He pastors a church in Stratford, Ontario, which is 90 minutes to the west of here. And John was a guy that just cared for young adults, teenagers that were broken, that were living on the streets, having tough times, and he pursues this gal and just begins to love her, and as she's coming to the drop-in center that he's running, and when she's alone and in the hospital in a psych ward, John visits her and begins to just love on her and care for her. And that's what every one of you needs. It's what I need. When there's a crisis in your life, you're being hunted down. It looks like you are going to be dead with extreme prejudice quickly. It's gonna, like, everything's caving in. What do you do? And here's David. And out of the blue comes his best friend. They thought earlier that they'd already had their goodbyes. When David begins to run for his life, Jonathan, the two of them, had hugged and committed each other's families. It's like, listen, if you have any kids and you live, you look after my kids. And if you die, I'll look after your kids. And they've made this covenant that they're going to help out each other. They're committed to each other. They're going to be BFFs. They're going to be best friends forever. And here David is in the wilderness. He's being hunted. And at the very moment when he needs someone to help him, who can he trust? The Bible says that David can't even trust his 6,000, or sorry, the 600 guys that are with him. These are guys that are messed up. And Jonathan appears, and look what happens. It says Jonathan helped him do what? Find strength in God. If you're a friend today for someone who's going through a tough time, your job is not to be the answer to their problems. Your job is to point them to the God who can help them with their problems. You may be able to loan some money, but that doesn't answer the problem. That's not the solution. You may be able to give them a hug and just have them cry with you. You may be able to hear their story and all the pain it's going through, but friends, the bottom line is you can't change their life. Only God can. You can't change their circumstances. Only God can. You can help, but the best friend you need if you're going through a tough time is someone to point you to God and to say, God can do it. He can do it. Do you remember when you went to Freshwind? Do you remember hearing that Caleb guy that's on the band and writing these amazing songs? Remember when he was here when he was 12 and when he's 15 and he's having God encounters and God's speaking to him and saying, I can do this, I can do this, I can do this. Well, you can do this because God can speak to you. God can help you. And friends, if you don't have one of those persons to speak into your life, we're going to pray in a few minutes and we're going to say, God, that person needs to show up by the end of next week. They need to have been declared into your spirit by God to say, that's it. And if you don't know who they are yet, I'm just going to pray that God this week will begin to say to you, that person right over there, that person, that person. And some of you may be thinking, well, my best friend is going to be someone my age. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. Could be someone 20 years older than you that just has a call of God in their life to watch over you. I was talking yesterday to one of the youth pastors, and he's upstairs. And he was telling me that God marks out people for him, like people who don't know Jesus in his community, and says, you're to get that one right there. And so he just begins to focus on that person. I have one of those assignments from the Lord right now. I'm hoping to meet next week with one of the cabinet members from the Canadian government. And she happens to be the member of parliament for this riding. She may even be here tomorrow at church. She considers me her pastor, even though she's only been to church here once. But God's used me, used our church to begin to affect her life. And she's text me all the time. The election night that took place in October in Canada, I'm texting her, emailing her, praying for her, blessing her as the count's coming in, and it looks like she's going to win her third term. And I just know that this lady, God, I know what God's spoken to me about my assignment for this lady. And she's younger than I am. She's a single lady, and but she's in the Cabinet for Canada, Science and Technology Department. And God bless her, but she's got a soft, compassionate heart. She's someone that God wants to have in a closer relationship. And I don't know where she's completely at in her relationship with Jesus, but I just know that that's my assignment. It's one of my assignments is to speak into this girl's life, into this lady's life. And those of you that are here today, some of you need a friend, and some of you are that friend. And we're going to pray about that in a moment. Number two is when you get a prophetic word. And I'm not talking about someone gives you a prophetic word. And if you don't know what a prophetic word is, prophets, their role is to hear God for you, for another person, or for a group of people, or for a nation. And so a prophetic word is when someone says something to you that is about your destiny. It's from God. And God loves to speak to people. In fact, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice." If you're a follower of Jesus, you're called a sheep. Yep. And you're supposed to be able to hear God's voice for you and for other people. And one of the most life-giving things that can happen is when you get a thought from God that either comes from a person or from reading the scripture or just a revelatory thing that comes to you, and you know that you know that you know that God just spoke to you. And I've had many of those. They've been life-changing things. I told our church this a while back. It's one of the stories that I have in the book called On the Run, talking about David's life. And it was like a number of years ago, when I first joined this church 22 years ago, I was hired not to be a pastor. I was hired to be the administrator of the nightly revival meetings. And so my job is to be here three nights a week to do all the logistics. And it turned out that we had nightly meetings for 12 years. Somewhere between 4 and 5 million people visited our church over those 12 years. And you've heard some of those stories. People like Patty, people like Caleb, people like Paul and Yana, who are already here. And what God was doing in those days was just phenomenal, of just coming and meeting people and meeting people and meeting people. And in the middle of that, our church used to have a family camp. We used to have a place about an hour north of the city that we go to. And we're supposed to have a beach day this particular afternoon. And during the lunchtime, John and Carol Arnott, the founding pastors of this church, they asked me and one of our worship pastors at the time, Jeremy Sinnott, they said, can we meet with you this afternoon? It's like, okay, that means I can't go to the beach. And so I went to their place, and they sat down, and they said, we're thinking about who's going to be our successor, about who's going to be the next senior leader at Catch the Fire. We were called at that time Toronto Airport Christian Fellowship. And it's like, oh my goodness, this is going to be a deep conversation. And the very fact that I was in the room being asked to give my advice meant that I wasn't being considered. I understood that. I had no aspirations for that role. My role was to help John and Carol do their job better. I was very happy with that. The Lord had spoken that to me. So that's what I was doing. So Jeremy and I were tossing out all sorts of names of some of the most famous Christians that we know. And for every single one, John's going, I don't think so. Carol's going, I don't think so. And eventually Jeremy, who's a little wiser than I am, listens a little bit more. He goes, John, Carol, do you think you know who's going to be the next pastors? Yeah. Well, then why are we having this discussion? Well, we wanted you just to see what you think. And it's like, okay, so who do you think? And when they named the couple, it was the couple that were our youth pastors at that time, Kim and Darlene. And Kim and Darlene were the ones that raised up Paul and Jan and helped them. And Jeff and Tab are over here somewhere. Where's Jeff and Tab? Yay! They were the junior high pastors. And it was like Kim and Darlene, and everything in me said, oh my goodness, they are going to be amazing leaders. Absolutely. Younger couple, younger than I am. He's taller than me. She's better looking than me. Nice, anointed people, worship. They got the whole package. And it's like, well, that's who we're thinking. It's like, great. So anyways, we did have time to head to the beach. About a month later, all of our pastors are having a meeting together, and John and Carol surprise all of our pastors by saying, we've chosen who our successors are. And we're sitting around like a boardroom table, and everyone's like, what? Really? Like, what? You're resigning? You're retiring? And it's like, no. In 5 years from now, we want to just turn the church over. And when we turn 60, we want to turn the church over to a younger couple. And would you like to know who it is? And everyone's like, yeah. And when they said Kim and Darlene, everyone around the table jumped up, clapped, and just everyone knew that this was the right couple. And because I already knew that, I don't need to go and hug them right away. I can wait, and I'm just standing there clapping as people are rushing towards them. And as I'm clapping, standing at the table, the Holy Spirit talks to me as loud as you can hear me, and he says this, "Actually, you'll be the next pastor." And it's like, okay. That was a little disconcerting to hear what I thought was an audible voice that no one else was hearing. And so the celebration's going on, and I'm going, okay, clap my hand. When we got in the car to go home, I told my wife, and she's going, "Are you sure? Like you?" I didn't have any natural skills that I was sort of looking at myself in those days. My wife didn't feel much more optimism for me as well. That's just sort of where we're at in life. We were backup people. We're the behind the scenes, make everything happen kind of people. I love that role. It's the role that Jesus had. He never had his own business card. His card said, you know, doing my dad's work. So anyways, how do you sort of process a word like that? You just let it sit. And it just turned out a year later, after there's a public announcement of Kim and Darlene, and our church were very excited about that. But about a year in, all of a sudden, at one of our pastors' meetings, Kim and Darlene say, "We're going to take a year out. We're going to resign and just take a year out and try to figure out what God has for us. Is this really what we're supposed to do?" And at the end of that year, they said, "No, we're not supposed to be at Catch the Fire." And it's like, oh my goodness, oh my goodness. And so 10 years ago, my wife and I became the leaders, all based on a word. That's pretty good, isn't it? When things were very difficult, and some of you know some of the difficulties that Toronto's had in the last little while, we had SARS that happened right during one of our Freshwind youth conferences years ago. 30-something people died in the city of Toronto from this flu kind of sickness. Wasn't good. Wasn't good. And the danger of being in a public place was not good. And we had some financial things that happened. That was the year where instead of people coming in the thousands every single night to this church, they started coming in the hundreds, in the low hundreds. And it was just like the economics of our church that was all geared to have nightly people here. We had a staff of over 100 people at this church to facilitate nightly meetings, six nights a week, and hundreds of thousands of people every month coming to this place. And we had some real tough times. And in those real tough times, you need to know what God said to you. You need to have a prophetic word. And so here's David. He's getting a surprise visit, and Jonathan, his best friend, comes and says this, "Don't be afraid." Well, what's he, of course he's afraid. He's being hunted down by the king. Not good. "Don't be afraid. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be king over Israel." That's a pretty big word right there. From the prince, from the crown prince, the guy who's supposed to be the king is telling his friend, "Actually, I'm not going to be the king, it's going to be you." And this is the first time that David has heard anyone else say what he thinks he knows about his own destiny. David was probably about 12 when a prophet named Samuel came to his town and asked to see the sons of Jesse. And if you remember that story, Jesse calls all of his sons except for one, David. And Samuel knows that he has a plan from God to choose the next leader, the next king of Israel. And as he gathers those boys, and he sort of doesn't tell everyone what he's really there for, "I'm just coming to have a sacrifice in your town. Bring your boys. I want to pray for your boys." So the boys are standing there, oldest, and all the way down the line, and he's putting his hands on the oldest. "Oh my goodness, this is a good-looking, strong boy. Nope, 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 nope." When he gets to the last one, he goes, like, "Jesse, like, is this it? You got any more boys?" Because in his inner ear, he's heard the Holy Spirit say, "Nope, nope, 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 nope." And it's like, "Is there another one?" "Well, yeah, there's the runt, there's the little guy, and he's out looking after the sheep." Can I tell you about why David wasn't invited to that event? I don't know if you thought about that. If a prophet, the leading prophet for your nation, says, "Gather all of your sons, I want to bless your family," why would you not have one of your sons there? Here's why David wasn't invited. It's almost provable. It's still a little bit of maybes, But I'm going to suggest to you that David is the result of an affair. He's an illegitimate son, if I can say it like that. He's a bastard. He's not the son of Jesse's wife, at least the first wife. The reason, there's a whole bunch of little things in there. It's commented a couple different times in the scriptures. But the biggest one is Psalm 51 in David's own words. He says this. He says, I was born in sin. I was born in iniquity. And it's like, he talks about, if I can say it, my very beginning was illegitimate, is what he's talking about. And he's this guy who's had life go against him. His older brothers don't see him as a full brother when he goes to find Goliath. It's like, you're the troublemaker. And he's had a life of challenges that potentially he's a stepson. He's not a real son. He's not going to get all the privileges and benefits. But he perseveres because when Samuel lays hands on him and anoints him, there was nothing that's recorded in the scripture that said that there was a word from Samuel to say, you're the next king. Nothing. Just a blessing. Samuel knows what it's for, and I can't prove it, but I think David knows, I'm supposed to be the king. Oh my goodness, I'm supposed to be the king. And then now he marries into the king's family. He marries the princess after he kills Goliath. And it's like, oh my goodness, it's all happening. And then his father-in-law turns on him, and life just gets messy and terrible, and it's a disaster. And now the prince comes, and he gives a prophetic word, and he also says this, you'll be the king over Israel, I'll be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. Oh my goodness, that's a game changer, isn't it? If your enemy, if the reason your enemy is after you is because he doesn't want you having that role, because God's spoken it to Saul. And Jonathan hears this, and it's one of the most encouraging words that David could get. And friends, if you've not had prophetic words to be able to help you in your life, you need to seek after prophets in your church. You need to go to someone in your church and just find out who's good at this and say, I need you to pray over me and just what God's going to say. And you need to be listening for the Holy Spirit. You need to be having times where it's just you and God and say, God, speak to me. Help me to know what my destiny is. You need to be saying, God, I need to have some dreams so that when tough times come, I know exactly how to stand. Jesus said this about you and I. In this world, you will have challenges. Tribulations is what he says. But he has a but you're going to overcome. You can't overcome if you don't have a close friend and you don't know what God's will is for you. So that's very important. Number three, real quick, is this God of hope. So here's this story. Jonathan's left. David's by himself. He's got a group of guys, and they're all of a sudden find themselves like being caught off guard. And instead of getting into one of these ravines where they can go all sorts of different ways, they're on this mountain that's by itself. It is a mountain. There's no other recourse other than to go up. There's like this goat path all the way up to the top that people take, this little trail. And they're running up, and Saul's right behind. And every single person in that group with David is going, we're dead. Soon as we get to the top, we got to turn around and defend ourselves. So we have an advantage that we're higher, but they got 3,000 elite soldiers. What's David thinking as he's going up and around this mountain? Do you know what I think he's thinking? God, did I just get a prophetic word or not? Did I just get a word that says, don't be afraid? Saul's not going to harm you. Saul's not going to be able to take your life. Was that an accurate word over my life, or was that just pretend? I think that's what he's going through. And I can just imagine that as he's going up, he's trying to encourage the guys. Come on, it's all right. It's going to be all right. God's going to step in. God's going to do a miracle. But inside, he's probably going, oh God, oh God, oh God, you better do a miracle. And guess what? The God of hope stepped in. And just when they're about to be attacked, word comes that the Philistines are attacking on the other side of Israel. And Saul and all of his guys back off, and they go to fight those guys. David's life is spared because God stepped in. That's the God of hope. Your God is able to help you before challenges come, to speak into your life, to give you people around you, to help you to be able to stand. And when those challenges come, he's going to be there. He's going to be right there for you to be able to help you make good choices in all those challenges. That's who our God is. He's a God of hope. Let's look at this verse one more time. May the God of hope fill you with, what's the word? Joy. Not happiness. Happiness is based on good circumstances. Joy is based on God showing up. It doesn't matter what the circumstances. You can be in the middle of the Titanic going down and full of the Holy Spirit and have joy. And the Bible says that, or not so the Bible, but history says that some people were like that. There was a Salvation Army band that were worshiping Jesus as the Titanic's going down. Did you know about that? Do you know the Salvation Army bands that do their Christmas things and stuff like that? And they're on the deck, while the Titanic's going down, and playing one of their songs that they were doing was Nearer My God to Thee. Okay, so this is how we go. God bless you. And they're worshiping the Lord as they're doing that. God wants to be with you every time, and he fill you with joy and fill you with peace so that in your believing lives, this is a key phrase, friends, if you are having unbelieving lives, all bets are off. If you're going, oh, you can't, all bets are off. But if you hold on to what you know God's spoken to you about your life and your plan, his plans for your life, if you hold on to those and believe, don't give in to all the thoughts that Satan's saying. If you hold on, God's going to be there for you. That's his promise. He's going to fill you with life-giving energy. That's called power. That's called anointing from the Holy Spirit. And you are going to brim over. You are going to overflow with hope. That's our talk. If you are a person in this room that you're one of those 9 out of 10 people that doesn't know who you're going to go to in a hopeless situation, you maybe have lots of friends around you, but you're not sure in the worst tragedy of your life if any of them are going to stick with you. If you're a person that needs to have for God to speak to you and to identify who your friend is going to be, if you would see yourself as a person, I got lots of casual friends, but I don't have this person that is able to speak into my life and point me to God when difficult times come. You may have lots of friends that talk about all sorts of stuff, but probably most of them don't talk about God stuff to you. If you need a friend to help you to talk God stuff into your life, and you'd like God to bring that person into your life before next Saturday, I'd like you to stand up. Wherever you are, just stand up. You need to know who that person that you can just absolutely trust on in the worst situation. You're not sure that you know who that person is. May have lots of friends around, but someone who will dare you to believe for God and will keep pushing you to God over and over and over again. Here's what I'd like you to do. If you're sitting right around where someone is standing, could you just stand up and put your hand on their shoulder? Those of you that stood, put your hand in the air. And when at least one person has come to put their hand on your shoulder, put your hand down. So when someone comes, put your hand down. Put your hand up if someone has not come. There's still some hands over here. So if you're seated, just find someone who's got their hand up. Head over to them. Just put your hand on their shoulder. Again, put your hand down if someone comes to you. Here's what we're going to pray. I'd like you to stick with these people, because those of you that are with them, I'm going to ask the Lord that you begin to give them a prophetic word as well. So that's number two. But Father, we bless these individuals. Thank you for being honest, friends, for standing. And here's the deal. I believe that God wants to have every person to have someone as their go-to person. In a time of crisis, I believe that this is one of God's plans, is to have life-giving people to be able to speak into your circumstances and to point you to God. Not just say, well, yeah, you can phone the government office for help. You can go, let's go down to welfare to get some help. Let's go to the counselor at school and get, no, forget about that. We're talking about God, friends, who are going to push you towards God and say, God's the answer, God's the answer, God's the answer. Let's pray. Let's believe together. Let's fast together. Father, we're asking for these people that have been brave enough to stand, that you would identify who that person is for them. And for some of you, you're going to have a surprise. Someone's going to come to you this week, and they're just going to say, hey, if you ever need to talk, I'm around. that's going to be your signal that that's the person. For some of you, you may even have a thought right now. You may have a dream tonight, and you may see a face. And if you see a face or you think you know who that person is, I want you to be brave enough to go to that person, send them an email, send them a text, and just connect with them and say, I've been asking God to have someone who will speak into my life. Would you be that person for me? Holy Spirit, would you do that, please? Would you be the life, the giver of life for each of these people? We're asking this in Jesus' name right now. Now, those of you that are right around these people, if you feel that you have a prophetic word, if you feel that there's a scripture that God's given you, just begin to say that to them right now. Look at them and say, here's what I'm feeling God's saying about you. If you get it wrong, no big deal. But if you get it right, oh my goodness, it's going to be so helpful. So if you're around one of these people and you feel God's given you something, just go ahead and share it right now. If you're in the room and you haven't heard from God as to what your bigger calling is, can I get you to stand up now, please? If you're still sort of, we prayed about this already when Caleb was talking about, like, what's my purpose, God? What am I good at? Where am I going to make a difference? I loved the talk yesterday morning that David gave, where he talked about most of our lives, they're not going to be on the stage. Most of us aren't going to have our 15 minutes of fame. Most of us are going to be quiet behind the scenes people, but with a destiny, but with a purpose, with a God call in our lives. And if that's you, just put your hand up now. If you're standing, put your hand up. And let's gather around these people. If they're not completely sure exactly what their God purpose is, what their calling is. So Caleb, when he was just up here, was talking about that he's to bring God's presence. He's to somehow be involved in worship. That's what we're talking about. So put your hand up. Those of you that are seated, look around and find someone who's got their hand up. Go to them. So I'm going to help pray with you right now. Come on, guys. Stand up. Move around. Find someone. This could be a dating opportunity for some of you. Or at least the first step towards a date. You will not believe how many people have met their spouses at Freshwind. Oh my goodness. Happens every year. And then they see each other the next year, and they get brave enough to say, can I buy you coffee? And so keep your hand up until someone's come. If you've gone to someone who had their hand up, I'd like you to give them a prophetic word right now. Just ask the Holy Spirit for a scripture verse. Ask the Holy Spirit for a picture. Ask the Holy Spirit for something that is going to help that friend. And when you say it like this, I think. Don't say, this is, because you may be wrong. But say, this is what I'm thinking. This is what I'm seeing. This is what I believe God's saying for you. Say it in a neutral way that doesn't force them to have to choose right away. Holy Spirit, we're asking that you'd speak to each person. For those of you that are watching on God TV right now, I just want to bless you that God has a word for you as well. And I don't know how it's going to come. It could come from someone in the room where you are right now. It could come from someone at your church tomorrow. Could come from your office during next week, someone at your office. But God has plans for every single person. It says that in Jeremiah. And they're good plans. They're positive plans. God's always for us, never against us. So Holy Spirit, would you come for these people right now? Speak life into their lives in Jesus' name. Friends, we're getting to the good part. In about 2 minutes, we're going to switch to the full of joy part, the full of peace part. That's for everybody. Just give your word real quick. Give you another 30 seconds. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. The God of hope wants to speak into your life today. The God of hope. The God who will be there for you. The God who will be your provider. The God who will be your defender, your shield, your protector. The God who will help you when there's traps around you, snares around you. The God who will help you to overcome temptation. The God who will be there during trials and be able to speak into your life and help you to know exactly what's going on. The God who will be there in the successes, the God who will be there when everything is going well and will keep you on course, won't take you off because all of a sudden you got money or you got fame or you got lots of whatever. God will be there in the good and the bad and the in-between. That's his promise. Okay, everyone stand up. Everyone stand up, please. We're gonna have a group ministry time. How many of you know where the, if you're a follower of Jesus, how many of you know where the Holy Spirit literally lives in your body? How many of you think you know? If you think you know, put your hand where he lives. If you put your hand on your, over top of your belly button, you are correct. Jesus said this, in your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. And the Bible says he was talking about the Holy Spirit. I'd like you to put your hand right over your belly button. That's the sweet spot. That's where the Holy Spirit lives. Just put your hands there, close your eyes, and let's welcome the Holy Spirit to come and begin to fill you with joy. So Holy Spirit, would you come right now? Just begin to feel his presence, begin to feel his peace. Usually peace comes before joy comes. All of a sudden, stresses begin to go. All of a sudden, challenges, difficulties, they're just, you know, that's not what you're thinking about. All of a sudden, God begins to come and he begins to fill you. Just let it happen. Just close your eyes, hands on your tummy, and how about you say this, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come for me. Come to me. Fill me. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Father, we welcome this wonderful peace, this wonderful joy. Welcome the Holy Spirit to begin to bubble up in your innermost being, in your spirit. Your head may not know what's going on, but your spirit can be alive right now and just go, oh my goodness, that feels good. Friends, you are supposed to experience God. I grew up in a church tradition where any kind of emotionalism and experiential things were seen as negative. I grew up in a church where the scripture verse was written on the wall, be still and know that I'm God. Well, that's one verse, but it's not talking about you being still and not fidgeting. It's talking about you, in fact, the word knowing there is the word experiential know. It's not a head know. Be still and experience the overwhelming presence of God. That's what that verse is all about. Every character in the Bible that's in a, spoken in a positive way had an emotional God encounter. Holy Spirit, come. Now I want you just to open your eyes, keep one hand on your belly button, and with your other hand, reach over and put your hand on someone else's belly button and say more. Protect your belly button. Put your hand there and say more. Look at them. If it doesn't look like they're being filled, say more. Look at them. Look at them. Holy Spirit, come. Oh. Holy Spirit, may waves just begin to come right now. Holy Spirit just comes and washes over you. Washes over you. Joy begins to come and bubble up. How about you repeat after me? Everyone ready? Ho, ho, ho. Ha, ha, ha. He, he, he. Just let it begin. Let the Holy Spirit begin to come and just fill you. That's what he said. That's not what I said. We're just acting out what he wants to do. He wants to come and fill you. Fill you with peace. Fill you with joy. Wants to fill you. Say more. Ooh, Holy Spirit, come. Okay, keep one hand on your belly button and find a different person now. Go be in front of you or behind you. Find a different one. Protect the belly button. Put your hand on someone else's belly button. Say more of the Holy Spirit. Just move one step away to a different person. More Holy Spirit. Come on. Some of you are going, this isn't cool. Friends, this is God. Forget about being cool. This is God. Just let it come. Let it come. Let it come. We got one more prayer to go. One more prayer before we break for lunch. Just let him fill you right now. If there's youth leaders in the room, prayer ministry team, you can just walk around and lay hands on people if you'd like to do that. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Do you know how Jesus said in that very passage where he talks about, it's in John chapter 7, where he talks about out of your innermost being, rivers will flow. And he's talking about the Holy Spirit. That whole story began at a seven-day party. The Jewish people, friends, the Jews know how to party like no other culture in the world. They just have it down. And part of their taxes in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, but those people were taxed 23% every year. A tenth of their income went to the priests and the Levites and looking after the temple. A tenth of their money went for the festivals, the feasts that they had, and a tenth every 3 years went for the poor, the widows, the orphans. And in their taxes were seven festivals where everything's paid for. All the food, all the alcohol, everything's free. And there's one of those that's a party festival. It comes up in Thanksgiving time for Canadians. American Thanksgiving time in November. And it's called the Feast of Tabernacles. And people would build a tent out of leaves and palm branches, etc. And it's just a seven-day festival. And on the last day, Jesus stood up, and guess what he said? Of free alcohol. Jesus stood up and said, "Is anyone thirsty?" And he's talking about the Holy Spirit. If you're going to be a drinker of water, a drinker of soda pop, if you're going to drink milk, if you're going to drink alcohol, how do people drink? You have to have your mouth open, and you have to have your head slightly tilt back. Do it. Mouth open, head back. And friends, you have to do like this. You have to go glug, 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 glug. Come on, folks, do it. I'm thirsty. I want more. Holy Spirit, fill me. Glug, 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 glug. If you don't do the glugging, it just flows in and then drools. That's not good. That's not cool. Holy Spirit, come. Alrighty. Can I get everyone's attention? Can I get everyone's attention? There's one more group that we want to pray for today. If I could get your attention just for another 10 minutes here. If you are in the room, and when I began to talk at the beginning about all those negative things that are happening to individuals, forget about the world stuff, but the individuals being bullied, depression, lonely, suicidal. I'm not going to say all the time, but if you have periods of time where you are overwhelmed with those kind of issues, we want to pray for you this morning. We want to focus the Holy Spirit's attention on you specifically today. If you need hope, the God of hope is there for you. If you need that kind of hope to be put into your spirit, I'm going to ask you just to begin to make your way up to the front over here. So if you're a person that finds yourself battling loneliness, depression, suicidal thoughts, fears, anxieties, those are big issues in your life, not necessarily all the time, but periods of time where that's the case, just come on up. Prayer team, can I get you, School of Ministry students? Just come on, begin to move in amongst the people here. If you're a youth leader here and you want to come up and help minister as well, you please come and do that. Just move right in, friends. Move right in. Holy Spirit, come. Prayer ministry team, a whole bunch of you need to go over this way over here. Just walk over here to start getting ready to minister. Prayer team, keep going further, further, further. Guys, all the way over right there. Yep, guys and girls. Holy Spirit, come. Those of you that are on the mats, can I get you just to stretch your hands towards your friends? I'm going to guess that people right around you, someone right around you just came to the front. And if you know someone was standing close to you and they're at the front, I'd like you to just begin to say their name to your Father in heaven and go, "Daddy in heaven, one of my friends is up at the front right now. And I'd like you to just begin to pray for them. I'd like you to just begin to say things that you'd like God to do for them." You may know some of the circumstances. You may even know the people that are bullying. You may know some of the stress points in these people's lives. And I'd like you just to be an intercessor for that person. And those of you at the front right now, Holy Spirit, would you come? And friends, I got good news for you. The God of hope will make a way for you. The God of hope will make a way. He wants to bring people into your life that when you're not thinking straight, they'll think straight for you. And so, Father, we're asking that you would bring those kind of people to them. This week, by next Saturday, someone will be identified who's going to be that person for you. Holy Spirit, we're asking that that friend would be strong enough not to just say, yeah, but that friend would be strong enough to say, your problem is this, you're not believing. You're not holding on to what God said. You're not living a righteous life. And that person will be bold enough to challenge you, just like Patty was sharing about this John Brown. And John's one of those guys. He loves people, he cares for people, and he speaks truth into their life. And we're asking that the Holy Spirit will give you someone like that by next Saturday. And we're asking that the Holy Spirit would be giving you stuff in your spirit, a prophetic word, a word from God that you would just hold on to go, no, I have a purpose. I have a calling. I do not need to be afraid. I don't have to give in to fear. God will make a way. I don't know how, but he will make a way. And friends, we want to bless you. Prayer team, you can just lay hands on people right now. Prayer team, here's what I want you to pray for the God of hope to encounter them right now. That's what I'd like you to pray. Say that may the God of hope begin to fill you right now with joy and peace. May the God of hope begin to come to you and just in your inner spirit for you to know that you know that you know that God is with you. He's for you. He loves you. He smiles when he thinks about you. He's got plans for you. He's got strategy meetings that he's already had with angels just about you and your life. He knows the difficulties, the challenges. And he'll be there. He will be there. That's who the God of hope is. And in David's life, he's going up a mountain. And if you saw the movie 300, those 300 guys are just in one corner. And they know they're all going to die. And David's feeling, we're like that. We're battled in. We're being pushed in. And just when everything's going to turn hopeless, God showed up. And God sent a messenger. Friends, I wanted you to listen about this real quick. The Bible says in that passage that God sent a messenger to Saul to say that the Philistines were attacking. Here's something crazy. But Saul, for 3 years while he's chasing David, didn't once care about the Philistines attacking. The nation's borders were getting weaker and weaker and weaker. The Philistines are moving in from all sides because Saul couldn't care less about his nation. All he cared about was killing one guy. Why would Saul give up when he's got a sure victory? Why would he give up? Why would he give up? He can end it right here, all these problems, by just killing this guy. Keep on going. Another half an hour and we're there. Another hour and he's dead. Why would he give up? Because God sent a messenger. Do you know what the word for messenger is in the Greek, in the Hebrew? It's the word angel. Saul had an angel come to him that he didn't realize was an angel, but it was someone from God. And when that person spoke to Saul, even though he's vindictive and he's gonna kill this guy, he hates him. He's jealous for all the anointing on David's life. He's about to kill him and he wants to kill him. It's his only mission in life, kill David. But when God steps in, God sent, it would appear to be an angel. And when that angel, when that messenger spoke to Saul to say the Philistines are attacking, for the first time in Saul's life, he goes, oh my goodness, we need to go. Totally changed what Saul was planning to do. That's how God is. God's able to put people around you, change the circumstances. At the very beginning, we read a passage that says, but God. And I just want to speak over your life to say, but God. But God. I want you to think of something that's not going right. But God. But God can be there. God will be there. So Holy Spirit, would you fill these people right now? Prayer team, make sure you lay hands on everyone. The God of hope to come your way. Holy Spirit, would you take off all loneliness, take off depression, take off suicidal thoughts, and just put the Holy Spirit in you. The Holy Spirit in you. The Holy Spirit in you. Prayer team, you just keep going. Those of you that are here, not being ministered to right now, we're going to dismiss you, and we're going to be back at 2 o'clock this afternoon. Bethel Worship's going to be back on the stage. William Matthews is going to be the preacher this afternoon, so get ready for some good stuff from him. He's a great communicator. It's going to be a great day. Bethel band tonight, and David Slaker is going to be the last guy up tonight. And then after that, we're going to have fire tunnels. We're going to just transform the place into a monster Holy Spirit place. One of our guys who's a DJ, he's going to be doing a dance party at the end of the night. So we're going to have a great time. It's going to be a great day. And it's going to be good because the God of hope is going to be with us all day long. All day long. If you're at the front and you need someone to pray for you, like more than they just did, I want you just to put your hand up if you're at the front. You need someone to pray a little bit more for you. Prayer team, can you find these people? Guys with gals. So prayer team, come on up to the front. Find these people that have got their hand up. Just focusing on them. If you're a youth worker, just take a quick glance and see if any of your kids are up here. And if they are, you are very welcome to be involved in helping to pray. If there's a girl on the prayer team, there's a girl over here. There's a guy up here. Need someone to pray with. There's a girl over here. If there's some extra girls in the prayer team, got a couple girls over here. Yep. Yeah, they'll come down. Yep. That's all right. Don't worry about it. Yeah. We'll get you covered. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Welcome you. Welcome you. For those of you at home, let me pray for you before we dismiss. Father, thank you so much for every person that's been listening. And I just speak into your life and say the God of hope, he will be with you. That's his promise. That's who God is. He's a God who loves to give revelation to you. He loves to give you thoughts and ideas. He puts inspiring thoughts into your spirit. Sometimes your head gets it, sometimes it doesn't. That's all right. But he cares about you, and he will get that, get his information into the core of who you are, because he's got good plans, good thoughts for you. So Holy Spirit, we bless you to come. Fill these people. Release your hope and your joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, friends. We're going to see you at 2 o'clock this afternoon.